Welcome to this time of worship for Palm Sunday. It's the first day of what has become known as Holy Week. That will end with Good Friday and then Easter Sunday. As we begin this time together, let's pray. Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. When we see photos of royalty visiting places, as this one here, there are often cheering crowds, waving flags. Today we remember Jesus riding into Jerusalem on the first Palm Sunday. And yes, there were people, there were crowds who cheered him and waved branches from the palm trees. We join with those crowds in worshipping Jesus in song, after which we hear Luke's account of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on that first Palm Sunday.
Thank you. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When Jesus had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at a place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you'll find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus. And after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the pass down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the disciples in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'"
So why were some people getting so excited about Jesus riding into Jerusalem at that time? Well, Jerusalem would have been buzzing anyway. It was Passover time, one of the feasts that all Jewish men were expected to go to Jerusalem to celebrate. So it had been packed out. This was the annual remembrance of the ancient people of God, the Israelites, being freed from slavery in Egypt. So it was a time for celebrating their nationhood under God. And it was probably also quite a tense time for the occupying Romans, with this great crowd of people who longed to be free of them. At least some of the people would have heard about Jesus, of the miracles he'd performed, of the healings he had done, how his teaching and lifestyle seemed to have antagonized their own spiritual leaders. It may be that at some point, someone made the link between Jesus coming into Jerusalem on a donkey and the prophecy in their scriptures. Zechariah had written, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey." Was this Jesus, the king who had been promised to them, God's people, who would make them great again? Was he the one even to rid them of the Romans? The excitement spread, and the enthusiasm for Jesus spread, as such enthusiasm can spread through crowds. They didn't have flags to wave, or did they? The palm was the national symbol for Israel. They tore branches off palm trees and waved them. They were waving their national symbol. We, of course, view all this with hindsight. We know that victorious kings rode into conquered cities in a demonstration of their power and success on horses. Jesus was on a donkey, a symbol of service, suffering, peace, humility. Those characteristics of Jesus' kingdom that he had been proclaiming and living. Yes, Jesus, a king, born in a stable. Where's the King of the Jews? The Magi had asked. Jesus, the King, who was to die on a cross. The King of the Jews, Pilate had written on his cross. We know that Jesus had not come to rid the Jewish people of his day, of the occupying Romans, but to free us all from the consequences of sin and death, to live the new God life of the resurrection. He was a king who led us into battle against evil, who died for us, but was victorious as he returned to life again, life given to all who believe. Well, all the events of what we know as Holy Week took place in Jerusalem during this annual remembrance of the Passover. We hear of the very first Passover, when the angel of death passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt, when each family was to have a lamb to sacrifice.
Then Moses summoned all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go at once and select the animals for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it into the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the doorframe. None of you shall go out of the door of your house until morning, when the Lord goes through the land to strike down the Egyptians. He will see the blood on the top and sides of the door frame and will pass over that doorway. And he will not permit the destroyer to enter your houses and strike you down.
Passover was about recalling that centuries before in Egypt, lambs were killed and eaten and their blood painted on the doorposts of the houses of the Israelites, God's people. That night, all the firstborn sons of the Egyptians died in the last of the 10 plagues. But everybody in the houses protected by the blood of the lamb survived, and in the confusion caused by the deaths were able to escape from Egypt. The lambs had made their freedom from slavery possible. As we think about lambs, we recall that John the Baptist had called Jesus a lamb, the Lamb of God. John records in his gospel, "The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world.'" Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Annus Dei of many liturgies and choral works. So, how was Passover remembered at the time of Jesus? That focused on lambs. 5 days before Passover, every family was required to choose a lamb for Passover. According to Jewish historians, lambs used at Passover were brought from the fields in the Bethlehem area. Every firstborn male lamb from Bethlehem was considered holy and was set aside for sacrifice in Jerusalem. So the shepherds would choose only the perfect firstborn males and drive them into Jerusalem through the sheep gate. Each family or group of 10 people would choose a lamb on Lamb Selection Day, the ninth day of the month Nisan. What we know as Palm Sunday would have been Lamb Selection Day, the ninth day of the month Nisan. Families then kept the lamb with them until the 14th day, when it was sacrificed in the temple. One particular lamb was selected by the high priest as the perfect lamb to be the Passover sacrificed on behalf of all the people. And this lamb was processed into Jerusalem from the east to be greeted by crowds of people waving palm branches and singing verses from Psalm 118 as they celebrated God's delivery of their ancestors from slavery in Egypt. "God save us," they sang. "God grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." God save us. Hosanna. Hosanna. Jesus followed this same route on the same day. The chosen Lamb of God, who would be sacrificed on behalf of the world. God save us. He would. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." He was the Lord himself. The chosen Passover lamb was kept on public view for 4 days so that it could be inspected and seen to be perfect. we shall remember this week that during those next 4 days of what we call Holy Week after Palm Sunday, Jesus, the Lamb of God, was inspected, interrogated by chief priests, elders, Pharisees, Sadducees, and found to be blameless, perfect. Pilate, governor of Jerusalem, and Herod, governor of Galilee, could find no faults in him. He was without defect, as the Passover lamb was expected to be. After those 4 days, the Passover lamb was bound to the altar in the temple at 9 a.m. In his gospel, Mark records that was the day and the time when Jesus was bound to the cross. It was the third hour they crucified him, and the third hour of daylight is 9 a.m. The national Passover lamb was to be killed at 3 p.m. In his gospel, Matthew records, now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, that is 3 p.m., there was darkness over the land when Jesus, the Lamb of God, died. None of the Passover lamb's bones were to be broken. John in his gospel records, but when they, the soldiers, came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his bones, in order that scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. Jesus' bones were not broken. As the high priest killed the Passover lamb, he said, "It is finished." When Jesus died at the same time with the Passover lamb in the temple, John records Jesus saying, "It is finished." Jesus came into Jerusalem as King, the Son of God himself. Jesus came into Jerusalem as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. His wounds have paid my ransom. His wounds have paid my ransom.
Jesus is King, humble on a donkey. Jesus, the King who sacrificed his life for his people. And Jesus, the King who returns to life after death, as we shall celebrate next Sunday, and is alive forevermore. Jesus, the King who now reigns in heaven, and one day will return to reign on earth. We state what we believe using words written by St. Paul. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And we confess that although as Christians we acknowledge Jesus as our King, we so often let him down. Gracious God, you have done so much for us, and we so little in return. You ask for humility, and we are often a proud people. You ask for willingness, and we are often a stubborn people. You ask for repentance, and we are often a deaf people. You ask for service, and we are often a busy people. Gracious God, you want the best for us. Teach us obedience. Grant us forgiveness, that we might be your willing servants. Amen. May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son, and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. And we continue in prayer. Today's special prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant, and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the mind to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King. Like Jesus, help us to love you and serve one another, and to go on loving through insult or praise, through acceptance or rejection, in the sure knowledge that your Spirit is with us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We are aware of so much conflict in the world, especially of what is happening in Ukraine. Lord, we ask that the leaders of peoples may hold to the values of your kingdom, and uphold what is right and just. We thank you for signs of your love and care in action in desperate situations, and pray for all who seek to live in love and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are facing great challenges, those whose lives are threatened by natural disaster, those who've lost everything but their life, those who've had their trust in others broken, those whose employment has been taken away, those whose health has failed, those who've been bereaved. And we ask that they may receive help to reassure them that they are loved and valued. And offer ourselves to help where it's possible. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we join together in praying the prayer that Jesus gave to his followers. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Oh,
Many people in churches today will receive crosses like these made from palm leaves to reflect on as we journey through this week. As you journey, may Christ crucified draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Hosanna.